Hi, this is Danny Doyle, back with some more of my Fire Emblem Path of Radiance 0% growths. I'm actually using a different save file. I accidentally deleted my old one, or the one that I had been recording, but thankfully I had a previous attempt saved, which is mostly the same. The biggest difference is that I got a little bit luckier in Chapter 8, and I still have 2 uses left in the elixir instead of 0. I also have the poleaxe, which might be a little bit useful, but it's only 2x effective damage, so it's not as big a deal as it would be in other games. I'm also here with Jacob, and Jacob, I have a surprise for you. One thing I didn't tell you about the save file that is a pretty significant difference. Do you want to guess what it is?
Is Boyd already promoted?
No, Boyd isn't promoted. Oh god, I can't imagine sinking. Do I even have enough bonus experience for that?
Probably not. You don't even have a Master Seal yet.
No, I managed to recruit Ilyana in this playthrough. She's also a lot stronger than I remember. Look at that. She's got 45 HP, 13 might, 75 hit. Like, I don't know why I thought she was a terrible unit.
I mean, she's only 1 rain in 0% growths, apparently, so that'll hinder her a little bit, but...
Yeah, but I can get rid of Titania. I can pair her up with Titania using the Awakening pair-up mechanic and just, like, make Titania stronger.
Okay, that works.
Like, look at her compared to an Iron Axe. It's 5 more might.
So Ilyana gives, like, plus 5 strength, apparently, whenever you pair her up. That's pretty neat.
It's really weird. On an unrelated note, do you want to talk about forging?
Oh yes, forging! Forging's amazing.
I'll let you go first, because you are very excited to talk about this, have been for the entire playthrough. How do you feel, like, about forging? What do you usually do with forges?
Forging in this game works very different to how it does in a lot of modern Fire Emblem games. In this one, it's very, very customizable. Depending on what part of the game you're in, you can forge different weapon types, and you get more as you go throughout different chapters. Right now, I think you can only make, like, iron of each weapons, and then, like, the basic tomes, like wind, fire, and thunder.
Yes.
But with forges, you can add extra might, hit chance, crit chance, or remove weight off of weapons for, you know, an extra cost whenever you purchase the weapon. But in that way, it lets you have, like, a higher might weapon. Higher might weapon with a lower weapon rank. So, for example, Ilyana here in Titania's inventory has more might than a steel axe, but it has as many uses and as much accuracy as an iron axe. So anyone with E-axes can now use this really strong axe. Now, whenever you get into the late game, you can start doing, like, steel weapon, javelins, hand axes. The tomes are a little too expensive to forge for my liking. I think the tomes are just fine the way that they are. And you can only do 1 forge per chapter, so if you really want to maximize your number of forges, you kind of have to do one every single chapter, but money is not a problem in Path of Radiance, especially in the mid to late game. You'll have plenty of money to sink into just countless forges.
I am actually a little bit worried about forge money for this playthrough. I haven't, like, done a ton of planning ahead in terms of, like, figuring out the exact math. But I do know that, because normally what you do is you forge hand axes and javelins because you want 1-2 range, or at least that's what I usually do. But you do get the... because, like... A lot of enemies have 1-2 range, and, like, Path of Radiance mid to late game just becomes put hand axes on Oscar and Kieran and, like, stick them out in the middle of a group of enemies, watch them kill people.
Oh yeah, especially when you've ace-supported them or even given them soul, they don't die. They just never die, no matter what you put them against.
But that's because they actually have good strength. Like, hand axes actually don't have that much might. This has lower might than an iron axe, so even at max forge, it's going to be weaker than a Max Forge Iron Axe. You do eventually get access to silver, which I almost never take advantage of because it's so expensive. But I'm thinking that it might be the only way to deal decent damage with units just at their base level.
That will be true. I usually end up forging one or two Silver Lances in the late game just to get Marcia a little bit extra attack power, because Marcia is my only unit whenever I play Path of Radiance. So I just think, like, every stat booster, the boots and everything into her. So I'll give her, like, a forged Silver Lance to help her get some easier two-hit KOs against some of the bulkier late game enemies.
Well, if you're excited about Marcia, we can get to the chapter. Because Marcia is going to join, not at the beginning, but eventually in the chapter. And the sooner we get going, the sooner we get Marcia. Who I also love. I like Jill better, even though Marcia's probably the better unit. Just because, like, nostalgia. I remember loving Jill's, like, going from the bad guys to the good guys character arc when I was, like, 12 and playing this game.
Oh yeah, Jill has a beautiful character arc with how she progresses as a person. But when it comes to gameplay, I just love Marcia so much. You get her just like a couple chapters earlier, and you can just sink your angelic robe. I want to say you get like a Draco shield sometime here in the near future you can give to her. You can give her an early game energy drop to boost up her strength a little bit. And she just like her cavalry, because she also has Super Kanto, she just snowballs out of control.
She's definitely, in a vanilla playthrough, your best unit, because she joins so early. Her bases leave a lot to be desired, though, so she's probably not going to be as good as she normally would be in this. She's still good, like, she, flying is good and Super Kanto is good, but she's not going to be, eventually she turns into your best combat unit, or one of your best combat units as well, and she's never going to be that.
She's pretty much going to be carry Ike to the seize point, or carry person to the drop zone.
Yeah. Or just, like, for a couple of chapters, maybe she can do a tiny bit of chip. But we did get two not as good as Marcia units. This is Rolf. I don't think we need to spend too much time talking about Rolf. He's an archer, but he has nothing that Shannon had going for him. He's got terrible stats. He joins later, so he doesn't really... Even if he had Shannon stats, he wouldn't really be outclassing enemies. He also only has E-bows, so he can, like, just use iron bows in his personal weapon.
The only thing Rolf has over Shannon is that he has green hair, he's an archer, and he has 5 points of strength, so he is the perfect Gordon replica.
He has access to a triangle attack that you'll never use.
That is, if you're willing to give Oscar bows.
That's why you'll never use it. he also has to be promoted in order to triangle attack, so even if I did, because, like, Boyd, Oscar, and Rolf have to all be promoted and all use bows in order to triangle attack, which is a guaranteed hit, guaranteed crit. If I didn't have to, like, raise both Boyd, Oscar, and especially Rolf, that might be tempting as a thing to do against some of the, like, upcoming bosses. But even then, like, can't use it on any boss who's surrounded by walls, because you can't shoot through walls, and you have to have the unit standing in a triangle around the boss, which they can't do if they can't shoot him in a triangle formation.
And another thing, before we go to Mez, another thing that hinders Rolf down is, yes, he has the personal bow, but since weapon effectiveness is only doubled in this game, just like an FE7, 16 might sounds like a whole lot, but with 5 base strength, and it'll be so hard to feed him kills on the map, so that strength is not going anywhere anytime soon. So he sounds like an ideal unit for taking down flyers, but you're just as good using, especially in the vanilla playthrough, you're just as good using Boyd with Forge, or even just Boyd with an Iron Axe.
Well, and also, the first time that we end up fighting flyers is 1, 2, 3 chapters from now, unless you count, like, you have the option to kill Jill, I guess, in Blood Runs Red, but the first time that you end up fighting flyers that you actually want to kill is 3 chapters from now, so you're going to have to struggle with these stats, not even dealing effective damage until then. And at that point, like, that's a very... They're crows, which are not as strong as Hawks, but they're still pretty strong. It's a chapter you want good units in. You don't want to be training people on the crows.
And it's such an open map with, and those crows are so fast. He's not going to be doubling anything, and he'll probably have some pretty shaky hit rates against two. I mean, I guess the Rolf bow has like 100 hit built into it, so maybe he'll be like reliable chip or something, but...
I've crit too, but like, again, he's just terrible. He's just terrible. Mist is also pretty bad. Like we were gushing about Riss's magic being 10. She's got 4, and she joined so much later than him. And in Path of Radiance, you usually don't need 2 staffers before you've promoted a mage, and then once you get to the point where 2 staffers would be helpful, you have a mage for your other staffer.
Yeah, the biggest thing with Mist, it's a matter of like early versus late game, because Riss's early game just completely stomps all over Mist. Like, Riss heals more, he has a little bit more durability, he'll have the higher staff rank. Like, go to Mist's staff rank. I think she has like E.
Yeah, she has E. Rank. She starts at E.
I think it's E and some change. I don't think it's base E. I'll have to double check myself, but I don't think it's just flat E rank. But that's still really bad to start off with just E stabs. Now, when you're playing the long game in a vanilla run, Mist gets a horse on promotion. Yeah, she gets swords, but who cares? She's going to be so bad with them anyways. And you just want her as a staff bot anyways. But mounted staff bot with Super Kanto, where she can run in, heal somebody with a men's staff, run out of range. It can be super, super helpful for keeping her out of tight spots while also giving your party the healing.
Yeah, that's the one thing she has. Well, and she shows up in the Black Knight fight for free, so if you do plan on killing the Black Knight, like, she's worth investing in at least to get up to Physic. But even with a horse, I mean, Riss's Physic range is usually going to be sufficient that you don't need Kanto. And I'm just not a huge fan of Mist. Like, I don't think the effort that you put in is worth what you get. A horse is nice, but staffers are already, like, not a big deal in Path of Radiance, because oftentimes your units are strong enough not to need healing.
That is true. You don't tend to take a lot of damage just because there's so many unpromoted enemies going up against your busted cavaliers. Mist is usually the healer I use, just because I like having her for the Black Knight fight. She's usually my Master Seal person. The moment she hits level 10, I'll give her a Master Seal. I try to have her promoted by Serenus Forest, because I find her pretty helpful there, just because she can be very mobile and help out wherever you're needed on the map.
I actually like waiting until after Serenus Forest, because you have the desert map, then you have a map that it doesn't really matter, and then you have the swamp map. Having a horse in those two maps are not... it's not as good as normal, because horses are actually more hindered than infantry at that point. But that's just a personal preference. Like, it is good to have Kanto even if you have low move.
That is true. And we're totally going to need Mist for the Black Knight fight, because we're beating the Black Knight, right? Right?
I'm going to drop a building on him.
Are you or is Nasir going to drop a building on him?
Yes. We got 2 more units. They're yellow. I'll talk about them in depth when we get to actually control them. For now, all we get to do is give them orders.
I want to spend 10 more minutes talking about units, though.
I can't move them directly, but I can tell them to move to a specific area. The important thing to note is that they're furries. When they're in their fursuit, they can fight, but when they're in human form, they can't. Their gauges build and fall over time.
So let it be known that when Leth is a cat girl, she's docile, but when Leth is a furry, angry and scary. So how are we going about this map? Are you going to try to get the treasure? Well, considering you're sending Tatiana that way, I think that's a yes.
Yeah, I'm going to try to get the treasure. That's also why I'm sending the goose up there. The path of least resistance is just to go down. The treasure's not too important. It is a restore staff and a talisman, but stat booster is good. I say that having not given the speed wings away, but that's because I'm saving them for someone special.
I think the restore staff, this is the game that the restore staff is kind of like the least needed in. There's so few status staves, and the couple that are on, like, they're so late in the game, they're not a problem to have to worry about. Now, something that makes getting these, because there's gonna be a pirate running towards the houses over here, and what kind of makes it tricky is infantry units have normal move on these beach tiles. I think they're called like shoals or something. Infantry units have normal move on it, but I believe cavalry have their move cut in half on these beach tiles.
Yes, and I think infantry have slight... I always forget because, like, there's desert sand and then there's beach sand. I think infantry might have, like, slightly less move, but not significantly less move. But mages have the exact same move on basically all terrain. Really? Not you, dick.
Hey, look, it's Soren performing like he usually does. Now, that pirate that heads for those houses, he reminds me of the Chapter 9 Erica route pirate, where if you don't move like Seth full move every turn towards that pirate, you're not getting the house he's going towards.
Yeah, that he's not really a huge problem, because you can kill him before he gets there. The problem is that there's a ton of enemies here who you have to like deal with stopping you from getting to him. And then later on, his headbanging friends show up.
Yes, I love the headbanging pirates. Rolf is a good unit, guys. See? Proof.
Also, poleaxe.
How much does the poleaxe do to Titania? Just for
it's a lot. When I was testing, it was like her fucking health. Granted, like 38 hit. I'll do it, and I can heal her if she gets hit.
She'll just crit. Oh, it didn't work like last time.
No, it didn't work.
Ooh, rough level up.
This is also the point where there may be some casualties starting this chapter, and I might not care.
Oh no, so if we lose Soren, you're not resetting?
No. Well, because he doesn't even die, he just does the I must retreat.
Because he cannot fall here. Also, we're getting to the point of 0% growth, so that becomes one of my favorite parts of the game, where you need, like, 3 of your units to kill off one enemy.
Yeah, Titania needed help to kill that unpromoted fighter.
She was just setting up a kill for Boyd.
The nice thing is that the cats will move before enemies. So I'm pretty sure Leth one rounds this guy and I can just sort of ignore him.
It's like genealogy where the green units go before the red units.
Well, so green units, if they're like completely green, which I guess I should touch on, like these guys are yellow. I can give them vague orders like move to a target or stop moving or run away from enemies or whatever. They will move before enemies, but units who are green, and therefore, like, completely out of my control, will move after the enemy.
The green ones are completely ungovernable, and they love to throw themselves into enemies.
That's okay, though, because the green units that are most important are basically unkillable outside of Maniac mode.
Oh, I can't wait to it.
I know. I knew he was going to do that too because he did it last time. Thankfully, the more they get beat up, the more likely they are to transform, further cementing that, like, he's just a kinky furry.
He's just a sadist. Or a masochist, that's the right word.
Hey, I'm not going to kink shame. I'm not going to yuck someone else's yum because, you know.
Apparently that pirate has a thing for your villages.
Oops, that's not my strong unit. That one is. Yeah, he survives. I'll do a little bit of...
At least he gets crit.
I actually need him for the prison escape, too. I'm a fucking idiot. Okay.
Is this the first reset?
I know. I am tempted to leave him dead, but I think I need him for the prison escape. It makes it easier. It makes it... fuck, whatever. Yeah, no. We'll stop for now. Why did you have to call his crit instead of Titania's?
I can't control these things.
Alright, well, we will stop for now, and get back up to this point instead of yammering for 20 minutes. I'll see y'all next time.
We'll be right back.